Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Happy Saturday to everybody. Welcome to USC Marshall's webinar, What the Coronavirus Means for Small Business. Today, we'll be discussing monetary resources available to small business in today's COVID-19 environment. We hope you're well and staying safe. So we elected to host the webinar today, Saturday, so we could provide you with the latest information coming from the Small Business Administration this past week, though it continues to change. We'll be focusing first on the recent tax law changes affecting small business, and then provide you with the latest update as of yesterday of the available resources and programs offered by the SBA to help small business get through these very difficult times. Hello, I'm Stephen Mednick, Associate Professor of Entrepreneurship at the Lloyd Greif Center for Entrepreneurial Studies at USC Marshall School of Business. Today, I'm joined by Gray Kling, CPA and Lecturer of Accounting at the USC Leventhal School of Accounting, Marshall School of Business. Greg is an expert in tax and accounting matters affecting small business. Greg, thank you so much for joining us. Let's also welcome to our webinar and to the Trojan family, Mike Daniel, Regional Director, Orange County Inland Empire Small Business Development Network. Mike is an entrepreneur and small business owner. Mike, welcome and thank you for joining us. As we all know, we're involved in a global crisis. We'll get through this together and learn much from the experience. Some things will remain the same, while other things will likely change forever. But as we've always done, we will move forward. As an entrepreneurship professor and longtime consultant with the Small Business Development Center, I'd like to share what I've been suggesting recently to my anxious students and clients. I remind them that rapid change is not new. We've been at an accelerated change, pace of change, since the beginning of the 20th century. Change has been and continues to be a perfect backdrop for entrepreneurs and entrepreneurial thinking. Change creates opportunity. Right now, business and civic leaders are thinking in an entrepreneurial manner by imagining and creating new customer solutions using given means coupled with the creation of new means. For entrepreneurs, this is not new. For others, the world of possibility just grew bigger and brighter. Some of these new customer solutions may not have existed just a few weeks ago. Some may pave the way to future solutions for the long term, thereby creating new wealth. Over the past couple of weeks, I've been working daily with clients to help them frame new business models learned from recent customer interactions. Many of them have found that customer needs have radically changed, and they're in a position to access their current means combined with new means acquired because of their long-standing business relationships to deliver new value in short order. So I'm happy to report that for some small businesses, but not all, that business demand is booming. Plus, there's a feeling of doing good while delivering new customer value. For those clients who are not in a position to pivot into new business models, I encourage them to determine the amount of cash needed for the foreseeable future. I don't know, 3 to 9 months out. Immediately rework all budgets based upon necessary cuts. Panic now, not later. And for those who are in a position to take on debt, look into the many recent loan programs that Mike will talk about in just a few minutes. In short, I tell my students and clients, the glass is half full. We're fortunate to live in a world comprised of individuals thinking like entrepreneurs, leading us forward. I'm excited about the future as we take care of the present. We are the Trojan family. Let's remain close while keeping our social distance. Thank you and fight on. I now turn the webinar over to my colleague, Greg Kling. Greg?
All right. Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Steve, for that. Before I begin, I want to give a standard disclaimer required by the university. Today's presentation is meant to be a high-level overview of the recent tax law changes applicable to small businesses. It is not intended to provide specific tax advice, and you should definitely consult with your tax advisor for more information. In fact, because we are not covering all of the changes in the new tax law, some of which may be applicable to you, it is imperative that you seek assistance from a tax professional who can guide you based on your specific situation and update you on the most recent IRS guidance, which is coming out on an almost daily basis. This morning, I'm going to highlight 8 tax matters connected with the coronavirus. On March 21st of 2020, the IRS announced that it was extending the due date to file certain 2019 tax returns otherwise due April 15th, 2020, such as a personal or business income tax return, and to pay any tax liability to July 15th, 2020. This is not only an extension to file the tax return, but also an extension to pay. Filing extensions are not new, but in past years, a taxpayer would have to estimate the expected tax liability and pay the remaining balance by the original due date of April 15th. Failure to pay the balance by the original due date would have subjected taxpayers to penalties and interest. So the difference here for 2020 is that taxes can be paid by July 15th without penalties or interest. Next, one of the most talked about provisions in the new law, which is known as the CARES Act, is the direct cash payments to individuals in the amount of $1,200 for individuals, $2,400 for married filing joint filers, and $500 per child. While this is not specifically a small business provision, I thought it would be helpful to clear up a couple of points since it has been so widely discussed in the news. First, the payment amount is reduced as an individual's adjusted gross income exceeds certain levels, with a full phase out, that is, the payment goes to zero, for single filers with adjusted gross incomes in 2020 exceeding $99,000, $136,500 is the limit for head of household filers, and the limit for joint filers is $198,000. And adjusted gross income, by the way, is just one of the lines on your individual tax return. You can see it on your Form 1040. Now, the IRS is going to base the amounts of the payments on the taxpayer's 2019 tax return if it has already been filed. If the taxpayer has not yet filed the 2019 tax return, the payment will be based on the taxpayer's 2018 filed return. Which brings me to the second point. The payment is actually a rebate with regard to 2020. Thus, if you receive a payment, which again was based on your filed 2019 or 2018 tax return, and your 2020 adjusted gross income exceeds the threshold amount, you will be required to return the payment. So we want to be careful because the idea here is that you may receive a check and then you will have to pay it back if your adjusted gross income is beyond the limit for 2020. Earlier this week, the IRS launched the Employee Retention Credit for businesses that have been financially affected by the coronavirus. The credit is specifically designed to encourage businesses to keep employees on their payroll. The amount of the credit is 50% of wages paid after March 12, 2020, and before January 1st, 2021, up to $10,000 in total for each employee. Wages taken into account are not limited to cash payments, but also include a portion of the cost of employer-provided health care. Qualifying employers must fall into one of two categories. First, The employer's business is fully or partially suspended by government order due to COVID-19 during the calendar quarter. Or second, the employer's gross receipts are below 50% of the comparable quarter in 2019. Once the employer's gross receipts go above 80% of a comparable quarter in 2019, this benefit will no longer be applicable after the end of that quarter. So the idea here is that this rule is going to be in effect for businesses until essentially they get back on their feet and start getting back to income levels from 2019. Qualifying employers can be immediately reimbursed for the credit by reducing their payroll tax deposits by the amount of the credit. For employers who had an average number of full-time employees in 2019 of 100 or fewer, all employee wages are eligible regardless of whether the employee is furloughed. For employers who had an average of more than 100 full-time employees in 2019, only the wages of employees who are furloughed or face reduced hours are eligible for the credit. The next change in the tax law concerns what are known as excess business losses, which limits the amount of a loss that is allowed for tax purposes. This area of the law applies to businesses organized as other than C corporations. So, for example, it would apply to a partnership, a sole proprietorship, or S corporation. Prior to the law change, losses from a business were limited to either $250,000 for individual filers or $500,000 for joint filers, subject to an inflation increase each year in the limit. So the limit was increased each year after the law came into effect. So for example, prior to the recent law change, let's assume that a non-corporate business had a taxable loss of $700,000. What would have happened is the loss allowed on the tax return would have either been $250,000 or $500,000, with the rest being suspended under these excess business loss rules. So the CARES Act temporarily repeals this limit such that non-corporate taxpayers can deduct the business losses arising in 2018, 2019, and 2020. And these losses could be deducted against other types of income, or as we'll see in a moment, it could have created what's known as a net operating loss. So in other words, non-corporate taxpayers with a business loss will have a full loss allowed, which again can create a net operating loss, which we'll discuss in a moment, rather than a partial loss due to this excess business loss limit rule. Which now brings me to the net operating loss relief rules. So essentially, a net operating loss is when a business incurs a loss for tax purposes and the loss is not otherwise limited by another area of the tax law. Taxpayers were permitted to take these losses and apply them to reduce taxable income from other years. Prior to the recent change, net operating losses were only carried forward to future years, and they were only able to offset up to 80% of taxable income in such year. Thus, for example, a loss incurred in 2020 would have been carried forward to 2021 and beyond to offset taxable income earned in those years. The CARES Act provides that net operating losses arising in 2018, 2019, and 2020 can be carried back to each of the five preceding tax years. This is definitely welcome news for businesses that had income in a prior year but expect significant losses in 2020, as they will be able to carry the loss back to such years, again up to five preceding tax years total, and obtain a refund of some or all of the income taxes paid for such prior years. It is important to note here, similar to the excess business loss rule, that the law includes the 2018 year, so taxpayers should consider filing an amended tax return for 2018 if a loss was incurred in 2018 and the business had taxable income, or the individual, in any year between 2013 and 2017. So the idea here is that you really want to be working with your tax advisor to figure out if filing an amended return for the 2018 tax year would help you. The CARES Act, again, allows net operating losses to offset 100% of taxable income instead of the 80% limitation that previously applied. Next, we're going to talk about the payroll tax payment deferral. And I want to just point out, this is different than any of the provisions in the SBA package that Mike's going to talk about. This is payroll tax payments, so again, it's a tax issue. Employers are required to withhold Social Security taxes from wages paid to employees and also pay an equivalent amount in Social Security taxes from the business. Namely, wages are subject to employee Social Security taxes at a rate of 6.2% up to a certain limit, which are withheld from employee paychecks, and employer Social Security taxes in an amount equal to the employee withheld portion. Self-employed individuals pay both halves of the Social Security tax. The CARES Act allow employers and self-employed individuals to defer payment on the 6.2% employer portion of the Social Security tax on employee wages paid from March 27, 2020, which is the date of enactment of this new law, through December 31st, 2020. So again, wages paid between those periods of time, March 27, 2020 through December 31st of this year, the employer portion of the Social Security tax doesn't need to be paid right now. But let's make sure we're clear. This is not an abatement of the Social Security tax, but merely a tax-free loan from the federal government, as half of the deferral amount must be paid by December 31st, 2021, and the other half must be paid by December 31st, 2022. Similar to the payroll tax credit under the CARES Act, a law passed earlier in March, known as the Families First Coronavirus Response Act, provides a credit for qualified sick leave wages and qualified family leave wages for businesses under 500 employees. Thus, it is an employee count-based limit, not type of business limit. And such businesses pay wages from April 1st, 2020 to December 31st, 2020. In a nutshell, this act requires employers of fewer than 500 employees to provide paid sick leave and expanded family and medical leave up to specified limits to employees who are unable to work or telecommute due to certain circumstances related to the coronavirus. Generally, businesses that are required to pay such qualified leave wages are entitled to refundable tax credits based on the wages paid up to specified limits. Lastly, we turn our attention to an area of the tax law that has been in effect for some time, but takes on special significance due to the pandemic. A provision in the tax law that originated after the 9/11 terror attacks provides that qualified disaster relief payments paid by an employer to an employee are excluded from the employee's gross income when, among other factors, the president declares a federal disaster. So this provision became applicable on March 13, 2020, when the president made a declaration under the Stafford Act, which essentially means that he declared a federal disaster. Pursuant to this provision, an employer that provides a qualified disaster relief payment to its employees is not required to include those amounts in the income of its employees. Thus, the employer still deducts such payments, but the employee is not taxed on the income. The relevant question in light of the pandemic is, what makes up a qualified disaster relief payment? The tax law does provide that such payments may include reimbursements for certain personal expenses incurred as a result of the disaster. But it is uncertain at this time how to determine if an expense is incurred as a result of the coronavirus pandemic. We need to be clear here that the payments contemplated are to reimburse employees for personal expenses, as wage payments do not typically qualify for exclusion under this provision. In other words, the standard is whether personal expenses are incurred as a result of the disaster, and the employer chooses to reimburse the employee for some or a portion of such expenses. Currently, we don't have specific guidance. We have some general guidance from IRS. So whether any particular payment is a qualified disaster relief payment will ultimately be a factual determination, and we are awaiting additional IRS guidance. We do know that qualified disaster relief payments cannot be for expenses that are covered or reimbursed by another source, such as insurance or a grant from, for instance, a public charity. As you can see, there are a number of provisions in the new tax laws intended to ease the tremendous burden faced by taxpayers as a result of the coronavirus. Many of the provisions have detailed rules and record-keeping requirements. As such, and as previously mentioned, it is imperative that you speak with your tax advisor if you believe that any of the provisions apply to you. Back to you, Steve.
Greg, thank you very much. We've gotten a number of very specific tax questions. What I'd like to do let's defer some of these questions. Mike, I think you're probably going to answer some of these through what the SBA has come down with. And then maybe what we do is we try and address a couple of these questions once you're done so that either one of you can field these questions. So I know some people have raised their hand. For the sake of time, let's make sure that we stay on board. So Mike, I'm going to turn it over to you. You have the floor. Greg, thank you very much. That certainly reminds me that I need to confer with a tax specialist. Okay, Mike, you're up.
Perfect. Thank you so much. And thanks, Steve, for including me in your presentation today.
My pleasure.
Are you able to see my screen now?
Yes, you're good
Perfect.
To go.
Awesome. So thank you. And thank you guys for joining me. And a lot of your questions I'm probably going to answer as we go through this. So feel free to start writing your questions. I can see them as we're going. But really just kind of want to talk about, you know, what the SBDC is first. So let me grab control of my PowerPoint and, you know, just say, you know, welcome. So I'm the regional director for the Orange County Inland Empire Small Business Development Center Network. It's a very long name to say that we are a grant-funded program from the SBA. We cover Orange County, Riverside, San Bernardino counties. And what we are is a group of about 100 consultants that are here to help small businesses start, grow, and exit. We're funded by the SBA, funded by the state of California, and then several other entities. And so the great part is that we can hire people like Steve Mednick and others to provide one-on-one service with business owners, and we don't have to charge for it. It's already been paid for. So it's an amazing program that really a lot of people either haven't heard of or, you know, just have never come to, that provides a lot of service and a lot of great expertise. And so as I go through this, you know, I'll talk about kind of where we're heading, and obviously even consulting the way we do it has changed just because the needs of our clients have changed and people are really in survival mode at this moment for the most part. So a little bit about us. And so like first to start, you know, a little bit about me. So I own a couple of Rocky Mountain chocolate factories and a Sugar Daddy sweet shop. So my only suggestion as I show you this, if you're going to look up Sugar Daddy sweet shop, make sure you type in the whole thing. Cause if you just type in Sugar Daddies, you're going to get a whole different thing on your screen. So type up everything. But this is what I do for a living, as well as work at the SBDC and help clients. And, you know, my business was up at the end of February, year over year, we were up 55% in the three stores combined. We were really starting to figure out, should we open a location, starting to do a lot of things. And my brother and I are business partners, which that's a whole nother story we can get into about a family business and working together. But this is what one of my stores looked like about 2 weeks ago. And, you know, this is what it currently looks like now. You know, so it has been, you know, we've been forced to close down completely. I had to lay off 25 employees, and it's been hard on them, and it's been hard on us as their employers to really kind of see what this has done to not just my family personally, but all of their families. And, you know, what, you know, you can't predict this, right? I mean, certain things you can predict. A worldwide epidemic is so, you know, I mean, it's just something that, you know, it's happening. And now, as you know, to Steve's point earlier, we're trying to now figure out, when do we open, right? When does this world economy kick back in? When are we able to open and get back to business? And I'm sure it's not going to be business as usual, but we need to start to figure out that timeline and what we're going to do in the meantime. So that's really what I'm going to talk to you about today. So what we're going to talk about today, options for people's business, how we're doing consulting today. some employee information. I know Greg covered a lot of that as well, so I'll go through that pretty quickly. And then starting to help our clients prepare to reopen if they're closed or to get back to kind of back to where we were as far as, you know, hiring back all of our employees, getting back to what we should be thinking as the economy kicks back open again. The hope for me is June 1st is kind of the date that I've circled as to when I would be looking at going back to normal, but we're going to find out. So with that, you know, things that we're really trying to help our business owners understand is, one, if they have a lease, what do you do with that, right? Do you abate it? Do you defer it? You know, do you have any options? But the first option really is to talk to your landlord, right? So I have three leases. You know, I have two landlords. I have two stores in the same village in Shoreline Village. And then I have another landlord in Huntington Beach. And so one of my landlords, my lease, I have a 842 square foot store and the lease is $9,000 a month. I reached out to him and said, can you defer this? Can you abate it? He said, unless your insurance company is willing to do something, the rent is due on the first. Figure it out. So that's a $9,000 check every month while we're making no sales and generating nothing in revenue. In my two stores in Long Beach, similar thought, right? It's, can I defer it at least and push it back 90 days? It's pay the rent on the first. And so you have a lot of business owners that are trying to figure out, what do I do? Right. And so for me, my entire business is also tied to my personal side, right? So I have personally guaranteed all three of these leases. If I don't pay, one, they can evict me. And two, you know, my house is tied to this, my family, you know, everything. I mean, they can have my kids. That's perfectly fine. But, you know, I want to be able to keep some of my wealth and some of what I have. So just knowing kind of what people have available to them, we're trying to help people get through this. On the existing loan side, so businesses that have existing loans, we're asking them to go directly to their lender and ask for a deferment, meaning stop the payments for 90 days, and then we'll kick it back up again 90 days later. Most banks are very willing to do that. And so that's a really good option for people that have current loans. And then the last thing is insurance. So a lot of us have most of us have liability insurance of some kind, but 30% of all businesses also have what's called business income or business interruption insurance, meaning that if something happens in your business, like a virus, like a government shutdown, that your insurance policy should kick in and cover a certain amount of money while you're closed. So mine covers about $50,000 per store. There's a caveat to our insurance policy that's about 100 pages long that says if there's a pandemic, it supersedes everything else. And so you have a lot of these insurance companies that are right now not willing to cover any of this. And so I filed a claim, and that's what we're asking everybody to do. If you have a business income interruption policy, to at least file a claim. You have all of the congressionals or all the Congress for the state of California have all banded together, have written a letter to the state insurance commissioner, who's Ricardo Lara, and asking him to really file a claim against these insurance companies to pay out on some of this. French Laundry, which is a restaurant conglomerate out of Napa, they're the first ones to really file a lawsuit. I believe their insurance provider was the Hartford, which is the same as mine. And so you're going to see something come out of this with insurance companies having to cover some form or fashion of this. So with that, I'm going to go on to the next thing. So this is really what's available to businesses and business owners currently right now, right? So stimulus and SBA loans, and I'm really going to go into depth on the economic injury disaster loan and the payroll protection program. But there's also a debt relief program that I'll discuss. But other things that you're starting to see pop up, traditional loans are changing. They're morphing. They realize that they have to be competitive. Currently, you know, prior to, you know, February 26th, most of the rates for small business owners getting funding for their business was anywhere from 8.5% to upwards of whatever, you know, some ungodly numbers as well. Local governments are starting to jump in. You see the city of LA, you know, they have I believe it's up to $15,000 loan at 0%. You have the city of Anaheim and currently working with Start Their Own Loan Program. So really trying to figure out how cities and counties and other nonprofits can get involved and really help businesses that either don't qualify for some of these government loans and grants, or, you know, just a way to keep businesses going. Because what you might see come June 1st is half of these stores vacant on main streets. Just to give you a quick for example, next to one of my businesses, we have an International House of Pancakes. I'm sure everybody's been to one at some point in time. I know Steve goes all the time. But his rent is $18,000 a month. He is keeping on his manager and his lead cook, which they're both full-time employees. He's open for takeout only. He's doing about $100 a day. So his rent is $18,000 a month. He's not going to make it very long. The average business has about 15 days of cash flow. So that's half a month. And we've already gone through a half a month. So these businesses just do not have the capital to survive this. And so you're seeing a lot of things jump up. Crowdfunding is another possible piece for a lot of businesses. You're seeing them go to GoFundMe. You're seeing a lot of different sites come up and pop up. And then lastly, things that I usually would never suggest any business ever touch is a credit card. There are several credit cards that are 0% interest for 12 months. Usually not the suggestion I would make, but to get through three months, 6 months, 9 months, it's really about survival right now. It might be an option for some. My only caveat to that is I really want people to understand and do the math. If you're going to get a credit card for 12 months at 0% interest, what does that turn into come 12 months in one day? How much are you going to now owe if you don't pay it all off? We're trying to showcase that to people, but it is an option for people. So just wanted to make sure that people are aware of what that looks like. Let me go on to the next thing. So we're going to go through these three programs in depth. So the EIDL loan, or the Economic Injury Disaster Loan, the Paycheck Protection Program, which is a very misunderstood program that just to inform you now, SBA submitted their interim final rules, policies, and procedures that now are sitting with the Treasury that will then go to OMB or Office of Management and Budget that will then go back to the SBA. So even though you have these banks that are taking applications, it's not going anywhere until the SBA has a final ruling on what this looks like. So this program has changed three times in the last week. So I'm going to give you what I know that is correct as of today, but come Monday, it might not be the same thing. And then we're going to talk about the SBA Small Business Debt Relief Program. So let me kind of go through this. So Economic Injury Disaster Loan, this is the EIDL or the disaster loan program that comes out of the SBA. The SBA is the lender here. So the SBA lends money to businesses when a disaster occurs. Now, typically what happens is you get a hurricane, a tornado, you know, it could be an earthquake, could be some small disaster in a isolated part of the country. The SBA is not prepared, nor could they ever be prepared for something to this magnitude. This affects every single business owner in the United States. This is 30 million businesses that, for the most part, have all been affected somehow from COVID-19. And so they're trying to ramp up. They've had a couple different iterations of what this application looks like. But what it is a $2 million loan for up to 30 years, and it's 3.75% for for-profit businesses and 2.75% for nonprofits. Now, those nonprofits have to be a C3. C6s do not qualify. So it's got to be a 501c3. Okay, so non-religious. And so again, $2 million. And so what you do is you fill out an application. I'm going to go through that in just a second. The funds are not to support your sales and revenue. The funds are to support your fixed debt to keep you up and going while we're getting through this disaster. Fixed debt, so payroll, accounts payable, your rent, mortgage insurance are all things that you can use for this. Okay, so I'm going to go through this and I'll come back to it because there is a component to this that everybody's hearing, a free grant, and I just want to kind of discuss that. So what's required of this loan? So this loan goes up to $2 million. What you do is you fill out an application, and the application, so this is open to businesses that are, the easiest way to describe this, it's open to businesses that are less than 500 employees. Okay, so if you have 500 employees or less, you qualify. My guess is everyone on this call would qualify. Most businesses qualify for exactly what this is. Corporations can qualify. Sole proprietors, independent contractors, all are eligible for this loan. What it's going to do is they are going to run your credit score, and they've lowered their credit score dramatically. I don't know what that actual number is, but it's gone from probably, I'm going to give you a guesstimate of somewhere in the mid sixes to below 500. So a lot of people will qualify. And so we're going to go through a lot of what you're going to need for this. Now, there is a collateral component to this. So loans made up to $25,000 require no collateral. Anything over $25,000 requires collateral if you have it. So if you have a home, they're going to ask you to pledge it. If you have something else, they're going to ask you to pledge it. If you don't have a home or you don't have something else, that's quite okay, and you can still qualify for this loan. But if you do have it, they're going to ask you to pledge it. Okay. So the EIDL loan, the way to start is there is an easy online application right now for everybody to go on. My suggestion is to go online and do it. It takes about 20 minutes if you do these two parts first. So SBA Form 5. For everyone except for a sole prop or independent contractor. If you're a sole proprietor or independent contractor, you would fill out Form 5C, fill out the paper form, and then Form P019 is really just what were your 2019, what's your revenue, and what are your cost of goods sold? Okay, so revenue and cost of goods sold. If you don't know 2019, it's because you haven't filed your taxes yet, or if you put it off, you can use 2018 tax returns in the interim to get through this process. So the initial process takes about 20 minutes. You're going to fill out Form 5, and then you're going to go online, and I'm going to give you the websites right there, covid19relief.sba.gov, or just go to sba.gov, and you'll be able to navigate into the economic injury disaster loan. The form, it looks like it's on my right-hand side of the screen. That's exactly what it looks like. The P019, this is what it looks like, but all you need are your revenues and your cost of goods sold for 2019. That's really all that you're going to need. So with that, this loan can be up to $2 million. The SBA disaster team will determine how much you get. You don't have any spot in here where you're gonna say, I want 50,000, I want 100,000, I want 2 million. They will determine it based off of all of the information that you're going to give them, which is a lot of information. Okay, but there's a starting point. You fill out this application, and then there's going to be a little box. It's a four-page application. Like I said, it takes 15 minutes to get through. It's really just your contact information. If you're incorporated, it's the ownership of the corporation, who owns what. Anybody over 20% is going to have to personally guarantee this over $25,000. The $10,000, or the let me rephrase that. The up to $10,000 advance is just that. It's up to $10,000. You're going to click a little box if you want this. And within 10 days of going through your application, they will deposit up to $10,000 into your bank account. Now, there's an algorithm as to how much of that $10,000 you would qualify for your business. What we're hearing is that it's most likely based around how many employees you currently have. Now, my suggestion to you is to put the max number of W-2 employees that you had at any given time in 2019, so you get the highest number in there. And that $10,000 upfront advance, as long as you spend it on fixed expenses like your rent, your payroll, your utilities, your insurance, your accounts payable that you might owe, it's going to be forgiven. But that's the only part that's going to be forgiven. The rest of it is a 3.75% interest 30-year loan. That is really inexpensive money, and you should really be looking at this loan as long-term. How do I get my business out of where I'm at and survive? And then I can use this money for a very long period of time to really jumpstart my business again. And so let me go through some examples. These are some other forms that you're going to need to fill out after. So once you fill out this form, it takes about 14 to 21 days for the SBA to come back to you. And they're going to ask you for a credit application, which is a 4506. They're going to ask you for this 1368 form that you see in front of you that's just listing out all of your sales over the last 3 years. Now, I get a lot of questions. What if I haven't made any money? That's quite okay. It's not necessarily how you've been affected from COVID prior to you filling out this application. Think through this, right? Maybe you had a contract that was going to come in 3 months, in 6 months, in 9 months. You're going to have the ability to explain that to them to say, I'm pre-revenue now, but I was, you know, all of a sudden I had this contract for $600,000 or $1 million in 6 months. So you can tell the story longer term. You really want to project out for a year of what has this done to you? What has COVID-19 done to your business? And to give you a for example, I'm helping one client. He has bomb sniffing dogs. And he is pre-revenue, but he just signed a contract to do Coachella Fest, right? So as we all know, Coachella Fest has been canceled. So that was about an $800,000 contract. He has lost that contract. So even though he hasn't made any money yet, he's put a lot of money into this business. He's put a couple $100,000 in, and he's got 10 dogs that are bomb sniffing dogs. He's had to train them. He's had to train some workers and handlers as well. So he's lost a tremendous amount of money. So he will qualify for some. We just don't know how much. That's what the SBA will determine, okay? To give you a real quick example of what a loan of $25,000, $50,000, and $100,000 looks like over 30 years at 3.75%, if you were to borrow $25,000, it would be $116 a month payment for 30 years, $232 a month for $50,000, and $463 a month for $100,000. So keep in mind, this loan goes up to $2 million. Now, it's deferred for the first year, meaning you're not going to pay anything until month 13 or you know, once you get past month 12. So deferred for a year, and there's no prepayment penalty. Let's assume you get $50,000. You can pay it off in the next month, in 12 months, in 2 years. It's up to you. But this is really inexpensive money to think longer term for your business, you know, because the economy is not going to snap back the minute everybody's able to go back to work. So, you know, think of this as longer term. There is a forgiveness component to this, but it's a very small amount. So don't apply for this just because of that. But if you're not sure if you want this, my suggestion is to apply because there is a fixed amount of money put into this. And that forgiveness piece, it's only $10 billion, which, you know, as we talk about only $10 billion, sounds huge to us personally, but to the federal government and 30 million businesses possibly applying for this, that $10 million gets eaten up really quickly. So I suggest an apply. You have up to a year to take it. You can decide, I don't want it. It's not for me. But my suggestion is get in line, apply, because it is going, it's not first come, first serve, but they are going to work down the line. So my suggestion is just get in line. And it's a really quick application. And that's the EIDL loan. So I'm going to go to the next one and I'll start answering questions as once we get past that. So the next one is the payroll or paycheck protection program. And this is what everybody hears. This is, keep in mind, the EIDL loan that I just explained goes directly through the SBA. So the SBA is the lender. This paycheck protection program goes through all of the government guaranteed lenders that and banks that you know, Wells Fargo, Chase, US Bank, Union Bank, and hundreds of others are all going to offer this loan. I just heard Cabbage is offering this loan, and you're going to see a lot of other fintech companies jump in and offer this loan. So this loan is really meant for payroll, okay? And it's meant for payroll from the time you get the loan to an 8-week period. So I'm going to explain exactly what that means, but this is up to $10 million. It's 1%, and it has to be paid back in 2 years. There is a 6-month deferral, meaning from the time you get this loan, you won't have to start paying it back for 6 months, but this is what it is now. Now, the only thing that you can use this money on is payroll, and payroll's got to be 75% of it. And then you can use it for rent, utilities, interest on any debt. And I'm going to answer a question because I know everybody's going to ask it. Yes, you can apply for both the previous loan that I explained and this loan. You would just have to use them for different things to have the forgiven piece of it. So let me go on to the next slide. So there are no fees for this loan and there's no personal guarantee needed. Okay, so no personal guarantees and there's no collateral requirements either. Eligibility, again, under 500 employees. Everybody will qualify for this. LLC, sole proprietors, all qualify. So a lot of you, I've seen questions in the chat box of, if I'm paying for an independent contractor, do they count? They do not. They need to apply for this separately from you. So they do not count as part of your business. Okay. So we'll get into some of those as well. So it's a really interesting algorithm, the way they get to the number of what you qualify for, the max amount. But basically what you're going to do is you're going to take your 2019 payroll for 12 months, right? So from January to December 31st, you're going to take that whole amount and you're going to divide by 12. That's going to give you your monthly average. And then you're going to multiply it to 2.5. So your monthly average times 2.5 gives you the amount that you qualify for. Okay. So really simple, really quick, really easy way to do it. So if you haven't been in business for an entire year, that's okay. You take 6 months. If you've only been in business for a month, you're just going to take that month's worth of payroll. Okay. And then things that are included in payroll, because that's a really good question and people are asking this all the time. It's salaries, wages, commissions, and similar compensation. It's payment for vacation, medical, sick leave. It's payment for insurance premiums and group health care, payment of retirement benefits, payment of state and local tax assessed on the compensation of the employee. So for smaller businesses like mine, most of my employees are part-time. You know, they're not getting up to the $100,000 category. But for businesses that have employees that make over $100,000, when you add all this together, each employee is capped at $100,000. So if you paid them $100,000 plus benefits and the total came to $150,000, per employee, they're only going to allow you to count $100,000 in that calculation for the year divided by 12. Okay. So payroll calculations, really easy way, you know, quick down and dirty. If your annual payroll for 2019 was $120,000, you're going to divide that by 12 and then you're going to multiply it times 2.5. You would qualify for $25,000. If you had $1.2 million of payroll, and keep in mind, I went to Cal State Fullerton for math. So I have to use really easy calculations. That's why you see really basic numbers here. If you divide it by 12 and add 2.5, you get to $250,000 max of what you qualify for. Okay. So it's a real easy calculation. The banks are really hesitant to even offer this program. You're seeing the banks don't really want to jump in. I know that there's been a lot reported of how much has already been taken. That's not accurate information. No one has actually, the SBA is not taking this in yet. So what you're seeing are just preliminary numbers of applications that are coming to different lenders. Some lenders haven't even gotten involved yet because they don't actually know the total SOPs or standard operating procedures from the SBA yet. So a lot of people are waiting. How much can be forgiven? Because this is what everybody cares about, right? Keep in mind, the payroll protection program is a loan. Don't look at it as a forgiven piece or a grant. It is a loan, and it's a really good loan. It's a really inexpensive loan. It's a 2-year loan at 1%. That is an amazing loan to get you through this short period of time. Now, the SBA created this really to cover payroll, not for anything else. It's to keep your employees employed. So the way this works is, let's say I apply for that loan today and I get it May 1st. So from May 1st to June 30th, because June 30th is when this program ends currently. That might change, but currently today, the program ends June 30th, 2020. So from the time I get the loan to June 30th, I take an 8-week period of time, and everything that I spend on payroll and then some other expenses, all my other fixed debt, is forgiven. Okay, but it's only for an 8-week period from the time I get the loan. So we're not backtracking. It's from the day I get the loan. So let's just say it's May 1st, because it's really easy to figure that out, to June 30th. I would basically submit all my documents for payroll, rent, anything else that I didn't use, the EIDL loan or the economic injury disaster loan, if you got that. You submit all of these documents, and what they can quantify and they can qualify, they will reduce that out of the loan, right? Or out of the total amount that you qualified for. So let's just assume that you qualify for $25,000. So starting May 1st through June 30th, you spent $20,000 on payroll, and then you spent $2,000 on rent, and maybe $1,000 of other things. So you qualify for $23,000. You submit this to your lender. This doesn't go through the SBA. This goes to the lender, and you qualify for $25,000, but you only have $23,000 of forgivable expenses. Well, they basically cancel out that $23,000, and now you have a $2,000 loan at 1% for 2 years. Okay, so that's how this works. Really simple. People are trying to make it harder than it needs to be. It's really not that complicated. Now, there's some caveats to that, right? So if you reduce your payroll, so they're looking at 2019, keep in mind, they're not looking at where you are today, where you were a month ago. They're looking at 2019 for the entire year. And they're saying, all right, if your average monthly payroll expense was $10,000 a month, we expect you to be at $10,000 a month from May when you get this loan to June 30th when this loan ends, or over that 8-week period that you're going to exhaust this, right? So if you are more than 25% below that expense, then the forgiveness is diminished a little bit and decreased. We don't know what that is yet, because like I said, the final ruling has not been weighed in on. But if you don't spend at least 75% of this loan on payroll, it just turns into a loan and less is forgiven. Okay. Currently, there are going to be several SBA lenders that are going to be willing to do this. On the right, you have a form. It's called a 2483. The SBA loves giving numbers to everything. This form is what most people are filling out. Some lenders, the larger lenders, have created their own online form. So it's going to look very similar, but there's a calculation. If you can see right up here where it says average monthly payroll times 2.5, and then also the number of employees. This program isn't meant to, you don't necessarily have to hire back the exact same employee. You know, for a lot of businesses, might've been a good opportunity for them to get rid of some of the employees that they didn't want anymore. Maybe they went on unemployment insurance and they don't necessarily want to hire them back, or vice versa. The employee didn't really like working for that company. It gives them an opportunity to go seek something else out. So there's a little light shine that could possibly shine bright on both sides there for this. But really easy to understand. So you don't have to hire the same people back. What they're looking for is dollar for dollar, right? So if you spent $10,000 a month prior, they're looking for you to spend $10,000 a month once you get this loan. But it doesn't kick in until you get the loan. So a lot of questions were like, what if I'm not at that today? It doesn't matter. It's where you're going to be from the time you get the loan to June 30th, and you take an 8-week period. So the hope is that they're going to expand it beyond June 30th. But just because like businesses like mine, I'm not open, and I can't be open. I've been forced to be closed. So May, I'm probably not going to be open either. The last loan is the SBA Small Business Debt Relief Program. So this program is very easy to understand. If you have a current SBA 7A loan, you will know it. It's right on your paperwork. If you have a current SBA 7A loan, the SBA is going to step in for the next 6 months, starting from March 27th. They're going to pay the principal, interest, and any fees for 6 months. Pretty straightforward. They're actually going to work with the lender, but if you are a client and you have a 7A loan, or if you know somebody that does, they should still work with their lender just to make sure that this kicks in and that it's going to work. Straightforward. So that's really what's available from the federal government. There was one thing that I just wanted to add to Greg's presentation. He did a great job of really explaining some of the relief for employees. The state of California has also offered a new sales tax deferment for sales tax through CDTFA. And so that's a deferment for currently, I believe it's up to a year, that's going to possibly turn into a loan. So I don't know how much you know about that, Greg, but I can definitely get people information on it. It's just coming out. And the state of California has also just kicked in $50 million to start a loan program. Problem with $50 million, when you're talking about 4 million small businesses in California, it's going to go really fast. And so that's what we're noticing with a lot of these city and county loans is that they're oversubscribed in the first day they come out. So people are just confused. I hope I was able to kind of really just isolate that these are pretty easy programs and there's just so much misinformation out there. These are not, you can't look at these as grants or forgivable pieces. You have to look at them as short-term and long-term debt to get your business viable again. And if some of it's forgiven, amazing. But if it's not, it's still really inexpensive money for your business to get you up and running. So the last piece that I have, and I know Greg already did a great job of covering most of this, but just the different types of EDD programs that are available for employees. And I won't go into it very much, but you know, disability insurance, paid family leave, unemployment insurance and paid family sick leave, and then workers' compensation. And then there's one other potential, and it's called DUA, or Disaster Unemployment Assistance from the federal government. And that is for gig economy workers, independent contractors, people that don't pay into the EDD right now and don't pay into all of these programs. If the president decides to enact this, which he has not done yet, all he has to do is make the decision. It's called Disaster Unemployment Assistance. Then it will funnel to the EDD and will make available to independent contractors and people that are taking owner's draws and not paying into any type of EDD format. And they will qualify for unemployment insurance for a specified period of time, but the president has to declare that. So last thing that we like to do, kind of end on a, hopefully on a high note, as people are getting ready to reopen their business or to regenerate sales that they lost, you know, we want to predict a gradual restart. So what does that mean for your business, right? What's the opportunity for you to kind of think through, where am I going to be June, July, August? Steve did a really great job of saying, hey, business is going to change. You have the ability right now to morph with it and change with it. How do you keep your employees in the loop and in the ready? So like my employees have all been laid off. I'm trying to keep in touch with them. Most of my employees, I'm still paying the additional amount that they don't recover from EDD. So I'm giving them a little extra. But and then a lot of companies have come out with free offerings around technology and, you know, online pieces. Take advantage of it, right? Understand, you know, if Google's giving you something for free, take advantage of it. If, you know, Facebook's giving you some free advertising, take advantage of it. Learn today, you know, how to connect with your customers in a little different way so that you're ready and you change your practices in your business. So with that, I'm going to stop there. And, you know, just again, SBDCs are throughout the entire state of California. So there are many SBDCs in Los Angeles. I'm going to hope that, you know, obviously after this presentation, you're going to realize that Orange County and Inland Empire is probably just a little bit better. I'm only kidding. They're all the same. They're all great programs. But we're here to give you accurate information. We're here to answer your questions. And we work with you one-on-one to give you step-by-step guidance. And we are mostly business owners. We're very specific experts in very specialized categories to help you through this and many other things. So with that, thanks again, Steve, for the time. And you know, I'll answer any questions.
Thank you all so much, Mike, Greg, and of course, behind the scenes here, Patrick, thank you so much for guiding us through this process. Thank you, USC Marshall Dean's Office. Teresa, thank you so much for encouraging us to do this in such a quick order. Hopefully we'll be back with some other programs. We'd love to explore more deeply the equity side. Certainly in class, I've been speaking to venture capitalists. I'm a member of Tech Ghost Angels, and we as angels have been discussing, you know, where do we stand today on reviewing companies, what's the appetite for equity investments today. So there are a lot of other things that we can address. Let's just hope that this gets much, much better quickly. It is important, of course, that we keep our distance. We all stay safe. So USC Trojans, the Trojan family, thank you very, very much for joining us on a Saturday. Again, Mike, Greg, Patrick, thank you so much. Mike, we'll probably talk to you next week.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks, Greg. Bye-bye. Take care, everybody. Fight on.
Everybody.
Fight on, yes.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.